Welcome. So glad you tuned in to Burnet UMC's live broadcast. We're here to worship and praise the Lord today. We need a fresh anointing and breath of His Spirit. And we're gonna sing and ask for that this morning. We've got our friend Michelle Golke here with us. Welcome her. Welcome all of you who are visiting or watching. I invite you to stand and sing with us.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sores, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the
First United Methodist Church of Burnet, and we're delighted that you're here with us to worship this morning, and we pray God's blessings on you as we worship together. We are excited about upcoming days, and we'll be able to worship together again in person. And just to kind of let you know, if you hear some audio issues this morning, we're working on putting things together so that we can both worship via live stream and have people in person here in the sanctuary and as well as in our other worship space. So if you hear a few little issues this morning, just bear with us. We're ironing out some kinks. And anyway, glad you're here with us this morning. Let's take a moment to remember our mission and our vision together as a church. And our mission is to make new disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And our vision is to love all like Jesus loves, build Christ-centered community, and serve in a way that welcomes others into God's kingdom. What a blessing it is to be engaged in that all-important work with you, and I pray God's blessings on all of us together as a church, even as we're separated by a distance at a time of social distancing. And again, look forward to that day that's coming soon. We'll be able to worship together. And a few announcements as we're getting started this morning that I want to just make sure I share with you. We are into the Stump the Pastors series, where our retired pastors and I are working together on kind of answering some of the tougher questions that you all would submit. There's still probably some time to get a question in or two. If you have one you want to submit to us, there's some instructions on how to do that on the screen there before you. You can either do that through our contact form on the website or through Twitter or Facebook. You'll see that information right there. We're going to be planning to reopen a soft opening starting on Father's Day, which is June 21st. There are going to be some protocols in place to do our best to ensure your safety. We're going to ask that people sit according to family groups, and we will put in place some measures to make sure we can keep that appropriate social distancing between groups. And of course, we ask people just, you know, if you're not well, stay home. That should really always be the rule. If you're not feeling well, if you might be contagious with something, just stay home. Be patient also with our check-in procedure, because as we start, we're gonna take the time to check folks in as they come in the door, and that includes taking your temperature with a touch-free infrared thermometer. And so just be patient with us as we start that back up in a couple of weeks. Looking forward to it, but there will be some challenges. But hopefully a day is coming soon where we can just throw all those restrictions away and get back to hugging and handshaking like we used to do. I also want to say that, you know, when we come together in worship, just know that you accept a certain level of risk in order to be here in person. As much as we can, we'll try to mitigate that risk, but there is a certain level of risk that we'll have to accept. So our next announcement page, is that the last one? All right, looks like we might be, yeah, that's the last one. All right, so as we're getting started this morning, let's take a moment to pray together. Almighty and everlasting God, we give you thanks and praise for this opportunity to be here, wherever here is, for each person that's watching and listening to this broadcast. Lord, we pray for your blessing on our musicians and on our praise team singers and on our technical staff and the internet connection itself and all the equipment that we're using. Lord, we pray your blessing. Prepare us, prepare our hearts and minds to hear from you this morning, Lord, and send your Holy Spirit upon us. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight. These things we pray to you, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand and sing with us again. Sing, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less."
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Christ alone.
Christ alone. Cornerstone, Rest in His righteousness alone. Fullness to stand before.
Working so hard right now. You may have recognized or not recognized. You may have seen an unfamiliar face with us this morning. That's because we have a guest, a friend of Jana and mine from Corpus Christi when we were there. Michelle Golke joined us. She was a member of the praise team of the church we served there and has decided to bless us with her presence this morning. And thank you, Michelle, for being here and bringing your family with you. Anyway, so we're delighted that you're here. Worshiping together, an important part of worship is to offer to God a blessing in return for all with which He has blessed us. And in this time of social distancing, there are a couple of different ways that you can do that. One of those ways is through an online gift through the church website. Simply go to fumcburnett.org. And you'll see on the top of the page, if you're on a PC, a little give link. And if you're on a mobile device, you'll just have to click on a menu button, and then that'll pop up a drop-down menu that will allow you to do that. Of course, you also have the opportunity to simply text FUMCB to 73256, and that will direct you to the same online page where you can direct your gift. Also, this is Communion Sunday, and normally when we're gathering in person, we have what's called a rail offering. Anything that you leave on the rail goes to help those folks in our community who approach us asking for assistance. And one way that you can do that is when you get into the giving, it defaults to the general operating fund in the drop-down menu there next to the amount that you're giving, but you can drop down to several restricted funds. One of those is to the assistance fund. And if you make a second mile over and above gift to that, that'll be like leaving a gift on the altar rail this morning with your communion offering, and we'll be sure that that gets directed appropriately. So, of course, there's always the traditional way of sending an offering when you can't be here in person, and that's simply to mail us a check. And you can make a similar notation in the memo for a second mile over and above gift if you want to direct that to the assistance fund. But simply mail it to 301 East Grave Street in Burnett, Texas, 78611. As we're receiving this offering, I invite you now to be with me in a spirit of prayer. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be a part of what you're doing in the world through our actions, through our response to your love, your mercy, and grace. And Lord, one of the ways by which we respond and one of the things which we do is we give back to you, Lord. Sure, the church needs money, but first and foremost, the reason that we give is not because the church needs as much as you call us to give. So we give back to you, Lord, and we give through the church. So bless these gifts, Lord. Make them more than they would be on their own. Multiply them for the sake of your kingdom. We love and praise and worship and adore you in all these things we pray, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. As we continue into this series on the questions that might stump the pastor or the pastors, as is this case, because I know I don't want to do this job on my own, so I'm getting help from our retired pastors, Reverend Jason Fry, Reverend Wayne Hawley, Reverend L.C. Johnston, and Reverend Bo Garcia, who are helping me with this series and providing input and feedback on the different questions that we're dealing with. And this week, we're going to be dealing with a question I'll get into in just a moment. But before I do, I want to talk a little bit about origins. Origins are important. They inform who we are. And when we're talking biblically, our origins inform our relationship with the Creator. Basically, our understanding of who God is versus who we are in our relationship with Him. And they define what motivates us. As a kid, when I was, I guess in my preteen years and a little bit into my teenage years, I was very into comic books for a season. and in the years since then, I've always enjoyed watching, you know, superhero movies or seeing a series on television that deal with superheroes and that sort of thing. I mean, I know it's pure fiction and completely made up, but they're fun to watch and to imagine with the creators of that kind of literature and movies. And what's always important in those stories is the origin story. How did they get their superpowers? I mean, that's the technical aspect of what it is, but what you find in those superhero stories with their origins is you also begin to learn kind of what motivates them. It defines who they are, what their struggles are, how they respond. Very often there's some sort of tragedy linked with it that they're kind of, for the rest of their lives, living in the shadow, or at least in response to that tragedy. Well, for us, for followers of Jesus, and not only for Christians, but also for Jewish folks, we believe that Genesis is the origin story for all of humanity. It informs who we are, who our Creator is, and our relationship with Him. And when we normally think of that origin story, Genesis, we immediately go, those of us who know something about the book of Genesis, we just immediately go to where it opens, the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, and the choice they made, and how they lost their place, how we lost our place in that garden, and that place of intimate fellowship with Almighty God. Today, we're going to be dealing with a portion of that origin story that almost immediately follows that. The story of two of the children of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. Abel has a favored position with God, and Cain is jealous of that relationship. And so as we pick up with our reading this morning, we're going to hear what happens because of that jealousy, the choice that Cain makes, and the consequences that follow. So this is from Genesis chapter 4, verses 8 through 17. Cain spoke to his brother Abel. And when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And the Lord said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you've driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." Then the Lord said to him, "Not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken upon him sevenfold." And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest any who found him should attack him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch. When he built a city, he called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. This piece of our origin story inspired our Stump the Pastor's question for today, which is, of whom was Cain afraid? And I want to say a thank you to Ron Falkenberry for submitting this question to us. And he even had some conversation with me by email about, you know, some thoughts, his own thoughts on that. And thank you, Ron, for that. And I'm going to try to include that in my remarks this morning. But, you know, this uh, This question, I mean, it kind of falls along the same lines as something I once heard about. I would say it's a joke, but it's not really a joke, but just kind of one of those trick questions that people ask from time to time. You know, what murderer in history once killed one quarter of the earth's population at once? And that would be Cain, because in that understanding, there would be four people. But if there were only four people, why would Cain be afraid to go out into the land? And not only that, where does wife come from? if Adam and Eve and had Cain and Abel, and one of the sons kills the other, who's going to kill him? And this actually came up at the Scopes trial in 1925, which brought the debate over between evolution and creationism to the forefront in the national spotlight. And there are some possibilities as we think of it. One possibility that's been suggested to me and that's been part of the conversations with the other pastors and with Ron is that maybe there was another hominid species and the fossil record would seem to kind of not contradict this, but if there was, and what I mean by that is I don't know how many of you have ever done the 23andMe or the Ancestry.com genetic test. And by doing those tests, and I've done one of those, and you can find out how much of other hominid species have influenced your bloodline somewhere along the way. For instance, I have more Neanderthal in me than most folks, which probably doesn't surprise too many people. but then there's also the Denisovans. I think I'm pronouncing that right. I'm not 100% sure. So scientists, sorry if I messed that up. But there were, you know, there's fossil evidence of other hominid species besides Homo sapiens that could possibly have existed around, you know, during the same time, and actually would have had to if there was interbreeding between those species. But then that begs a certain question, and the same thing gets asked in the next possibility, and that would be that maybe there were other tribes of the same species, other Homo sapiens, other human beings out there in the world that maybe had a separate creation story from Adam and Eve and from their children and so forth, but. But then it would beg the question, first of all, why would these other tribes or other hominids, why would they care if Cain killed one of his species? I mean, after all, that would be less competition for resources. And not only that, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says that, you know, sin came into the world through Adam and that we had a first Adam and all of us kind of fall into that. And we need a second Adam, therefore, who is Jesus. Also, Genesis chapter 3, verse 20 said that Adam called Eve because she was the mother of all who live. So there's another possibility. But you're going to have to brace yourself for the ick factor. and that possibility is that there were other siblings who are not mentioned in the Genesis account, specifically by name, whose names are not recorded in Genesis. I mean, we hear about Seth, who becomes the replacement for Abel, who was born after Adam and Eve were, get this, 130 years old. Now, you have to remember that Scripture says a little bit later on, after we get to the story of Noah, that God's going to limit the lifespan of human beings to 120 years max. And 130, of course, exceeds that. And then Adam lives like another 800 years after that. So if that's the case, and Adam and Eve bore children after they were 130, and which means that this business with Cain and Abel happened probably more than 100 years after they were born. So in all likelihood, I would imagine that Adam and Eve had other children, probably lots of other children over the course of those years. The ick factor, of course, is that this would require what you and I would consider incest. But remember that there is no recorded prohibition of that practice until we get to Leviticus, which takes place much later in the timeline of human history. And speaking from a genetic perspective, genetic mutations probably have become more frequent in recent times if we take a more literal reading of the Genesis account, then the genetic pool would have been likely less inclined toward mutation in that time. And the whole reason that someone who would be born from a pair of siblings would have deformities would be because of those genetic mutations that have kind of crept into our species in the years since then. And so there would have likely been a less chance of those kind of deformities happening. Okay, that's been enough of that particular discussion. But I think it's interesting to recognize that this is not a new idea, there would have been other siblings. In fact, it was the only conclusion that I could draw from looking at a painting that I saw as I was researching this issue. There's a painting from 1880 that I saw a picture of online called Cain Fleeing Before Jehovah's Curse. And it was painted by a guy named Fernand Ann Piestri Cormon. And it depicts an entire tribe of folks. The name of it is Cain Fleeing Before Jehovah's Curse. And it depicts an entire tribe of folks leaving the land and moving through some fairly hostile-looking wilderness, all of whom seem to be of the same species as Cain. Honestly, much of what we have to do with a question like this is to speculate, because in many places the text is simply silent on these issues. Also, I think we have to understand something that a youth director I used to work with said many years ago, and I kind of knew this but never heard it said in quite this way. It was a guy by the name of Aaron Wright, and there was one of his youth was asking him a question about this difference between creationism and evolution and which one is accurate and how do I reconcile what I find in science textbooks with what I find in the Bible. And he said to this young man, he said, the purpose of Genesis is not to be a science textbook. It's not to provide a comprehensive science text detailing the mechanics of how humans came into existence, or even to be an exhaustive genealogy of everyone who ever existed, as much as it is to tell us who we are in relationship to God. It's that origin story. It tells us who God is, who we are, what the relationship between us is, what sin's consequences are, and we get a great deal of that right here in this reading. Why we deal with a world and a cosmos that often seems hostile towards us, and the beginnings of what our hope is. Speaking of those consequences, we've already heard that the ground is cursed because of Eve and Adam and what they did. But now Cain receives a double curse. So it's like the land's not going to yield anything for him. And so what we see in the story of Cain and Abel is that what happened, to put it in contemporary language, what happened with George Floyd is not a new story or problem. We've been killing our sisters and brothers almost since the very beginning. We do that out of fear. We do that out of selfishness. So the first thing that I want to say this morning is that Cain chose a selfish path that had dire consequences. Cain chose a selfish path that had dire consequences. In fact, so dire are these consequences. And by the way, let me just say this about the word consequences. I mean, that's something we try to teach our kids from the very beginning, isn't it? I mean, I remember my mother and father teaching me the word consequences. I remember thinking, as I began to learn this word and hear it more and more frequently as a child, I thought consequences literally meant punishment. It can, but that isn't always the case. When an action happens, when we choose to make a certain choice, other things follow because of it. Jude, in a warning to the early church, says to the early church in a warning about a group of folks who have kind of crept into the midst and are trying to deceive the people of the early church, he says, "Woe to them, these who are creeping into the church, for they walked in the way of Cain and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error and perished in Korah's rebellion." Balaam is an interesting story in which, I mean, a lot of us, what we remember about that story is a donkey talked, spoke words, human language. But actually, the story is really about Balaam, who's a prophet, and someone's trying to pay him to go speak a word of divine prophecy against God's people. And he keeps trying to do it, and he can't do it, and he keeps trying to do it, and he can't do it. And eventually, he pays the price for it. And then Korah's rebellion is a situation that happened as Moses was leading the Hebrew children away from the land of Egypt and toward the promised land. It had gone on for a long time, and it didn't seem like they were getting to the land that was promised. And so a bunch of leaders within the camp rose up against Moses and challenged his leadership and authority. I mean, Moses himself was, in fact, a redeemed murderer. But because God had chose him, then God called down consequences upon those who led the rebellion and demonstrated without question that no one was to oppose the leader that God had chosen. So in the same way, Jude is kind of invoking the name of Cain, the name of Balaam, the name of Korah, in order to let people know that when we choose to go against what God has decided, there are consequences for our actions. And one of those consequences was that Cain was going to be rejected. And so second, I want to say people rejected Cain. People rejected Cain. Whatever numbers of people there were in human society at that time, excuse me, whatever other people there were in human society, they'd written off Cain, and Cain knew it. Even as God was pronouncing this judgment upon him, I kind of, you know, wonder if maybe Cain, when it became clear that God knew what he had done, you know, God comes to Cain and asks him, "What have you done?" And it's kind of like what he'd done with his parents when he found them hiding in the garden and said, "Where are you?" as though he didn't know, and then asked them what they'd done. Well, the same question, the same kind of question is asked of Cain. "Cain, what have you done?" And when Cain pretends not to know the answer to that question, the Lord says, now we're back. The Lord says to him, "Your brother's blood is crying out from the ground." The Lord knows what he'd done. And Cain must have been expecting at that point that God was just going to wipe him out of existence and remove him from the human family. But he doesn't. Instead, he exiles him. And Cain seems to think that this may be a fate worse than death. I mean, hear his words in verses 13 and 14 of Genesis chapter 4. Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you've driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be as a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." This is just one of the consequences, one of the types of consequences that people have to deal with when they sin against God and against their sisters and brothers. Brokenness results. And the consequences of that brokenness is a separation of relationship. A separation of relationship with God, but also with his sisters and brothers. Cain becomes an outcast. But God doesn't destroy him. God seems to offer a measure of grace to Cain. And so third and finally, I want to say, God still had a plan for Cain. God still had a plan for Cain, this murderer, this one who had killed one of the first few human beings to inhabit this planet. The Bible says he settled in Nod, east of Eden. And Nod, literally the name for it, means something like it comes from the same root word as wanderer or vagabond. And it means something like a reed that's tossed by the wind. And then not only does he settle there in this land east of Eden, but he has children. He builds a city. and names it after one of his children. And through him, the story of humanity continues, and that is recorded to some degree in the pages of Scripture. We don't hear much more about Cain's life, anything in particular, other than that he continues to be a part of the human family and the lineage that comes down to so many of us. There was continuing purpose in his life. And even though he's committed murder and has to deal with these consequences, God still wants him to fulfill the commandment to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And so the story of humanity will continue in this fashion. God makes covenant with his people, commands them to behave in certain ways. The people break the covenant, and God finds a way to restore the covenant, always dealing out consequences for breaking covenant, but also providing an opportunity and a way back, and always pointing towards a Savior and a Messiah who is to come. And when Messiah does come, he makes a way for us to begin to be restored to more intimate fellowship with God, to be restored to life, to be saved. And Paul says to the early church in Romans chapter 5, verse 15, "But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many." That's the way God works. In spite of our human failings, our decisions that we make that create ripples of evil in the world that get reinforced by ever more ripples of evil as people return evil for evil and violence upon violence, God dispenses grace and forgiveness. That's the way he works. He's all-powerful, ever-present, and all-knowing. He doesn't need sinners like us, but he's chosen us to be a part of his redemptive work in the world and the plan he established from the foundations of the earth. So here's the main point for this morning. I know it's not an answer to the question that was initially asked, and we did talk about some of those possibilities, but as I dug into this text, this is what came out to me. The main point is this: God redeems even the worst of sinners whom the world rejects. Friends, I've been in the presence of even murderers whom God uses powerfully to reach people with the message of the gospel. And were it not for some of those murderers who have repented of that sin and turned towards God, people like me could never hope to reach them. Like Cain, they have to deal with the consequences of their actions. I mean, I met these folks in prison during Kairos ministry. But just because they're in prison doesn't mean that God's done with them. Even if they have a death sentence hanging over their heads, it does not mean that God is done with them. As long as we have life in our veins and breath in our lungs, God is still using us or desires to use us. You know, most of the time when I preach a message like this, I try to reach that person or those people who believe that they have been written off by God, and I want to make an appeal to their heart to let them know that God's not done with them yet and that he still has a plan and a purpose for them. And I want to say that very clearly right now. But there's another question I want to ask as well for the rest of us. Maybe those of us that don't think God's done with us, that do recognize that God has a plan and a purpose for us. I'm drawn to the question of the ones you and I might have written off, the ones the world has thrown away. So pray over this today, sisters and brothers. Whom have you written off? And how might God be redeeming him or her or them? It might even be a whole group of people that you're thinking about. Now, I think I need to make it very clear. I'm not suggesting that anyone should enable another person to continue in their sin or enable someone to continue to sin against them, to continue to make yourself vulnerable to someone else's violence or taking advantage. There are consequences for sin. And sometimes those consequences, as we've seen with Cain here, sometimes those consequences are the separation of relationship. It's not always. And if we provide opportunities for people to continue to sin, to continue to abuse us, to continue to take advantage, then we become enablers and participants in their sin. But we can forgive people as we release them. And we never have to hate. We can choose love, even when we have to choose tough love. Love that, even though it's tough, still seeks the best for the other. As we prepare to receive the sacrament of the Lord's Supper this morning, communion, remember that it's not a table that you and I get to restrict or decide who is good enough or not good enough to come to this table. It's an open table. Jesus, even in his earthly ministry, was calling both the Pharisee and the tax collector, the prostitute, the drunkard, the murderer, calling all of them to that table together. Jesus is the one who calls us to the table. And if we're going to accept that invitation to the table, we just might have to sit next to somebody that we would not choose to sit next to. So I encourage you and I invite you to keep that in mind as we prepare to partake in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And just one more time, if you haven't already gathered some bread and juice or some other substitute, if you don't have bread and juice on hand, please do so right now. There's still just a little bit of time. But hear the words of this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to the table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray, and free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, you who created Adam and Eve, you who created Abel and created Cain. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which the Lord Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And at the end of the Passover meal, the Lord then took the Passover cup once again, and he gave thanks to you, Father, gave that cup to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here and wherever we may be. And upon these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. I want to invite you now to join me in a word of prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you for this holy mystery. A mystery not only because we don't fully understand exactly what's going on as we receive the sacrament, but also, Lord, a mystery because it's hard for us to fathom how you could welcome all of us to your table, Lord. But you do welcome us. You have given yourself for us, and now, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, enable us to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who gave us a model for our prayers, even as he taught his disciples the following prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. I invite you to sing with us.
Will your grace run out if I let how to cry. 'Cause I am a sinner. If it's not one thing, it's another. Caught up in words, tangled in lies. You are the Savior, and you take brokenness aside and make it beautiful, beautiful.
Amen. Before we dismiss today, I want to take a moment to share a word from Kevin Naumann. I'm not going to read the whole email. I tried to do that in the earlier service. It took a long time, but I want to share a couple of highlights. Kevin Naumann is with EMS in Marble Falls, and he is also the executive director of the Highland Lakes Crisis Network. And he called us pastors together to begin to talk to some leaders in the community about issues around racism, as well as an upcoming protest that's going to be going on in Marble Falls next weekend. And he wanted to share a word with us that came through someone else, but from the organizers, that wanted to make sure that everybody understood the purpose of the protest. And so I'm going to read a section that came to Kevin, and then he turned and pasted it verbatim into an email to the pastors in the county that were part of this. And this word says, "First and foremost, I want to express my deepest and most sincere gratitude for your show of support, community allies, for these young people. They were afraid to have their identities revealed in the beginning due to fears of retaliation. However, they now know that there are more people who are for them than against them. Yes, I am. We are fully aware that there is a national Black Lives Matter organization that has left the majority of the nation with a negative connotation of the terms Black Lives Matter. I can more than assure you that all the Marble Falls Peaceful Protest Group are not these people. They're not connected to those people, nor do we want to be placed in the same negative category. The organizers are Marble Falls high school graduates, and we are productive members of society, community volunteers, and law-abiding citizens. Only the most pure and sincere prayers will be able to break the power of darkness that perpetuates racism and hate." I also found out since the 8:30 service that there will be a protest here in Burnet next week, right after church time. And in even as I go and will be a part of the prayer support, just being available for prayers for people during the protest, I'm going to do the same thing here if I can, following worship next week. And I just want to encourage everybody to be safe. And to cover all of this with prayer. We have very little hope, if any hope at all, without the intervention of God and the grace of Jesus Christ. And so if you want to help with the Marble Falls needs, they still need like a sound system with music playing for one of the pavilions, water, Gatorade donated in packages for distribution, coffee, donuts, other breakfast items for the event setup team, canopies and tents for shade, 3 to 5 hand washing stations or sanitizing stations, 3 to 5 porta potties that are handicap accessible, preferably, disposable pop-up trash cans. Volunteers remain at the park during the march, standing watch, praying for anyone that may request it, and praying for the participants. Volunteers to assist with the cleaning of the park after the event is completed. Volunteers to host water hydration stations. Volunteer watchmen, extra eyes to keep an eye on the events and take notice and report, not intervene, if anything abnormal happens. 150 to 200 metal or plastic chairs to be set up in the amphitheater. A megaphone or bullhorn. Food, maybe some folks willing to barbecue or restaurants that are willing to donate food. People with cook trailers, there's not a budget for the event, so the more we can have donated, the better. And finally, there's going to be a prayer station and people throughout the park to be available for prayer as needed. And that's the area where I'd like to help, is just to pray with people and to pray over the event. I think it would also be important to have a group pre-walk the area to cover it in prayer and during the event as well. So if anyone wants to volunteer to help with this, let me know, and I will pass that word on to Kevin Naumann, get your contact information and so forth. But I'll tell you what, let's just pray over it right now. Almighty and everlasting God, we pray for these protests as well as others that are going on right now, Lord. We recognize that there's violence, and Lord, your perfect will doesn't include that violence. And so, Lord, we pray that people will listen to what's being said, that we will hear with our hearts and minds open to you, Lord, and to all your children. We pray, Lord, that you will restrain the voices of hatred, that you will restrain the forces of violence, that you will restrain the enemy's power, Lord. Keep him at bay. God, we love you, we praise and worship you, and all these things we pray, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. And now awake, O sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you, in Jesus' name.